three-part series that began with the thought of Hebrews, who in the days of his flesh, Christ, offered strong crying and tears, and was heard because he feared. Though he were a son, he learned obedience by the things that he suffered, so that he might be made perfect and the author of eternal salvation. Now, Jesus was incarnate. He was God, came in the flesh. And he prayed like you pray. And he felt like you feel. But he also was tempered by the God that was in him, as I hope you are. That you pray what you want, fleshly, but you also have a spiritual promise. And now, here's what I know it ought to be. Now, last week, Jesus said, Father, I don't want to go to the cross. Pass this cup from me. That's what you'd want. You want to go to the cross? No. Nails in your hand and spear in your side? No. But then he said, with the God part of him and the spiritual part of him, not my will, but thine be done. Sometimes you have to pray that as well. You'd rather something else happen, not going to happen that way. And so God, okay, if it's going this way, help me to appreciate that because you've got a plan. And we're glad that Jesus did that because had he not gone to the cross, there's no salvation. We heard, already read what? Only one person that could save us, read to us before communion, Jesus Christ, because of his death. Today in Matthew 23, we read the second of those earnest, desiring prayers that Jesus made. And again, you see what he felt. Then you see what he wanted God to do. And it was certainly an earnest prayer. Luke 23, beginning in verse 32. And there were also two other malefactors, some called thieves in other passages, led with him to be put to death. And when they were come to the place which is called Calvary, there they crucified him and the malefactors, one on the right hand and the other on the left. Then said Jesus, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. He really meant it. And they parted his garments, which they'd taken off of his body, casting lots for God away. And the people stood beholding, and the rulers also with them derided him, saying, He saved others, let him save himself, if he be the Christ, the chosen of God. And the soldiers also mocked him, coming to him and offering him vinegar, and saying, If thou be the king of the Jews, save thyself. And a superscription also was written over him in letters of Greek, and Latin and Hebrew, this is the King of the Jews. And though they did so much to him and hurt him so horribly, Jesus prayed, Father, forgive them. They know not what they do. Now, there's four things that I read that I thought were kind of strange. And first of all, he said, they don't know what they're doing. If you were a teacher and you taught for 3.5 years and the kids still didn't get it, what would you think? Am I a bad teacher? Are they just not very good students? And Jesus would go around saying, You have ears, but you will not hear. You have eyes, but you will not see. You have a heart, but you don't feel. And for all that he could do, they seemingly shut him out. How would you not accept Christ as who he was in what you saw and heard? How would you not in Capernaum realize that Jesus just spoke a word and a servant of a centurion in another house was instantly healed? How would that not affect you? How would you not come to Peter's little house, just a block away from the synagogue, and bring all the sick of the city, and they stand there, and Jesus comes up and just heals every one of them? How would you not understand this is somebody special? He must be of God. How would you not understand that? How would you not understand when he brought forth the scripture in such a marvelous way? How could you misunderstand? He said they don't know what they're doing. How would you misunderstand when you're part of a religious group that meets every Saturday, and on that Saturday you read Old Testament through the whole thing every year? Now I can kind of have thought about that, but you don't get to the begats and all those. Well, they're going to get past all of those people. But you realize, I guess, on the other hand, those are your people. You kind of like to hear about your family? I hope you do. That's our ancestors. So when they got to reading about the people of Judah, well, then all the Jews of Judah, that's our folks. Then talk about Nebula. They talk about Naphtali. Well, that's our folks. I guess maybe they'd enjoy doing that. But how could you miss the Christ who is standing going like a lamb to the slaughter? He born in Bethlehem. They would give 30 pieces of silver in trading him off and on. How could they miss it? But they did. And Jesus spoke correctly, and it's just an amazing thing. Father, they don't understand what they're doing. They just don't. That tells me that people can read the Bible and miss it. People can read the Bible clear through, maybe every year, and never get the message, never understand it. And there have been people who have done that, because if you're not reading it for the right reason, you'll miss it. If you're reading it to find flaws in it, you won't get it. If you read it so that it's just something that you do, like a book, you won't get it. If you read it with a prejudice, here's what I'm looking for, and when I read these words, this is what I think, then you won't get it. But the Bible indicates if you come to it with a very sincere heart, with an open mind, God, I want to know your truth, you'll get it. Now, not everybody in Jesus' day missed it. That's why the apostles got maybe 75%, don't you think? They kind of missed the resurrection and that, but they got mostly. He's somebody special. He's of God. And Peter confessed, you are the Christ of God. You're the one that was saved. You're the Messiah. They got that part. The women, for the most part, that followed with him, they got it. I think the women got it better than the men, frankly. Because they seem to have more hope and more faith than the men. They're ready to throw the towel in. And so then Mary Magdalene and the other Mary were saying, well, no, I mean, we saw him and all of that, and they were very with the whole program, and they believed it, they followed. When Jesus went to the cross, there was a whole bunch of people. It's almost like a parade, sad as it could be. I mean, people were crying all along the street as they watched him go. They got it. He shouldn't be crucified. This is not right. That's when Jesus stopped and said, don't cry for me. Cry for yourselves. Because in just a little bit, this city will be destroyed, and all your children will die because of the oncoming punishment, because I'm being rejected today. Cry for yourselves. They did not understand it. And even Peter later, in chapter 2 of the book of Acts, after healing the man that was at the temple, we heard about in a communion talk, and they were kind of wondering what to do with him, and Peter said, I know that through ignorance you did it. 3:17. As did your rulers. Religious folks had the Bible, read it, and missed it. Kind of a challenge, isn't it? We can read it and miss it. We can think we know the Bible and not know it. If we don't approach it with a very humble, open heart, God, guide me, let your word speak to me, let your word get into my heart, and people can read the Bible and do the worst of things. Nikita Khrushchev, you some will remember, personally, or at least maybe many here in Iowa, he came to a farm, Garst Farm, and checked it all out. Maybe some of you had some contact with that. But you remember him because he was contemporary to some of us, and some of his name in the history book. But Nikita Khrushchev won several awards as a boy in memory work. Went to a church, memorized the Bible, knew it, could quote it, and became a dictator of Russia, and was responsible, as Stalin before him, of the deaths of many people. Didn't seem like the verses really kind of tied in to what he was claiming to be godless at this point when he became the premier of Russia. Yeah, you can get the Bible. You can know the Bible. Doesn't mean you're going to get the Bible without an honest heart. God's made it just in such a place that he comes into the open, humble heart and lives there, but the others don't get it. And that's what Peter was telling them at that point. They didn't have the right attitude. Father, they don't know what they're doing. That's an interesting statement. So it's kind of like, Father, wait a minute. Ignorance. But he also said this, Father, forgive them. What's that indicate to you? Well, it means guilt, doesn't it? Why are you forgiven? Why is anybody forgiven? Well, because they did the wrong thing. Well, forgive me. I'm sorry. I apologize. Well, you did something wrong. You're trying to smooth it out or get rid of the difficulty, whatever. And Jesus could see that they are sinful people before God. He's asking God to forgive them, which indicates that forgiveness is what they've done as sinful people. Some people don't think they sin very much, I guess. They don't really understand the weight of sin. Had Jesus not prayed this, I don't know what God might have done. But he says, forgive them. And the third thing that deals with that is, Father, forgive them. How else could they be forgiven? Could they just do a little bit better? Could they just burn a few candles? Could they say a few prayers? Could they just sort of give more money? No, everything was now the place where only God could forgive them, and he only forgives them on his terms. And Jesus realized that, and every hearing this, Father, forgive them, that we go to the synagogue all the time. We pray our prayers through Moses and all. We are Jewish people and have all these blessings. And Jesus saying, you need to be forgiven by Almighty God. Father, forgive them, is what he was asking on their behalf. And the Bible indicates that sin, no matter how bad or good or indifferent or wretched we may call it, still all sin eventually and ultimately is against Almighty God. If you sin against yourself, that's a sin against God. He made you. Sin against another person, that's a person God's made. And if you just violate what God did, didn't hurt anybody, you don't think, just ignore what he had to say, then you've hurt God. In the 51st chapter of Psalms, we have one of those great outpourings of really earnest prayer. And when you read about this, you understand what Jesus is thinking about, of how God is the one that we approach in our sinfulness. You remember that David had committed a horrible sin. He wanted a certain man's wife. In order to get her, he decided that he'd kill the husband. But he wasn't going to do the killing. He was going to just, said Jews of the army, march him out to where a person would get killed for sure, and he'd be killed by the enemy. And it wasn't his fault, he didn't think. But God was calculating all of this. Our motives, our thoughts, our intentions are all under the understanding of God. And he watched this whole scene play out. As David killed this man. And after she cried a while and all that, then he took her into his house and married her. And in the process of time, they had a baby. And all this time, David seemed to think, well, I hate to do that, but it's over with, and everything's fine. But there was one really, really offended person, God. And it's not like, well, it's over with. You might have forgot, but he doesn't. You might say, well, it's so long ago. But that isn't anything of God. God's got the whole thing figured out, you see. And all things are recorded in his wonderful mind or book, as he calls it. And David got to thinking about all of that. And he says another place, I really couldn't sing. That's what sin does to you. I don't have any joy. I lost it. I lost my harp ability. I don't sing praise like I used to. I just don't have a harp. Well, no. You've ruined it with sin is what you've done. Now what are you going to do? Bring it back to life? You can't. It's been done. So Nathan walks in. And he says, I have a story to tell you. There was a man over here in your dominion that had a little lamb. He loved that little lamb, and he just took this little lamb, and he fed it, and cuddled it, and just like a child to him. I said, well, I accidentally listened to the dog and cat show on WHO radio in the morning. I don't know, I don't like cats too much, even my own. And so they tell about cats and dogs and how to take care of them, why cats and dogs do it, they do their personality, psychoanalyze and all this. And anyway, but one lady was saying, I have a dog that sleeps with me and I would have it no other way. But okay, that's fine if you want to. But she loves her dog and I'm sleeping with my dog no matter what. I'm telling you that this person loves their animal. You might not. I can't get that. But if you understand and love an animal, you understand the story better. I mean, he loved this little lamb so much. Well, he had next to him a very rich man. Had all kinds of sheep, all kinds of stuff. And a traveler came to the rich man's house. He thought, I will fix a dinner for this man who came. And he grabbed the lamb of the neighbor, that pet lamb, and killed it and served it for dinner. Now, there's certainly nothing wrong with eating lamb. Be standard. I mean, it's good. Eat it warm. Lamb's okay. But you don't go stealing the pet lamb, especially when the lamb is so appreciated. I mean, anybody, whether you like the animal or not, can just see the nasty, nasty thing he did of hurting his neighbor like that. And David jumped right onto the story. He said, well, that's a terrible thing. He said, I think we'll just execute that man, that rich man. We'll just kill him for that awful, violent thing that he did, killing a lamb, yeah. But we're going to also give the other man four lambs back for the one that he stole. Now, that'll never take it, will it? I mean, if you have a pet animal, you love that animal, that dog dies before dogs take that place? No, it won't. But that's all best you can do. So David backed forward, supposedly, and finally, when David got all of his bluster out, Nathan said, "But you're the man." You see, there was a man that had a pet wife, so to speak, had one wife, and they loved each other, and you split that up, and you killed that man, and you took his wife. And you've got many wives. You've got the wives that belong to King Saul before you, and you've got ones you picked up, and if you want more, I'll give you more. How many wives would make you happy anyway? What would you think? How many wives would it take to make you happy? I won't answer that. That's not that. Well, that's what he told David. David, he said, "You're going to be punished. And the child's going to die." And that child did die. So David, for the last 7 days before the child died, had laid on the floor, didn't take a bath, couldn't shave, couldn't eat, praying that God might somehow deliver the child, but he didn't. And as soon as he got the word that the child died, he got up, washed himself, and he went to the house of God. Here's what he said. The words like this, this is the psalm he made in relation to that awful thing that happened in his life. "Have mercy upon me, O God, according to thy loving kindness, according to the multitude of thy tender mercies, blot out my transgression, wash me thoroughly from my iniquity, and cleanse me from my sin, for I acknowledge my transgression, and my sin is ever before me." Everywhere I look, I think of what I did. It reminds me, everything I see about my sin, it's everywhere. Remember Macbeth? Shakespeare got spot. She had a blood spot on her hand where she killed other person. She'd wash her hand and wash her hand. Ow, spot. The spot never got, I mean, you couldn't see the spot physically, but you could see in your mind. "Ever before me, against thee, and thee only have I sinned and done this evil in thy sight, that thou mightest be justified when thou speakest and declared when thou judgest. I deserve worse than I got. I can understand why I have to give you the baby back. I understand that, Lord. Oh, please forgive me." And really, the whole thing is against you. Well, he sinned against the man, but he sinned against the woman. That's true. But ultimately, sin is against Almighty God. That's where we have to make our peace, you might say. That's where we have to make it right. You can say, "Oh, I'm forgiven. It's okay." But you haven't touched God yet. God is still the one. And the fourth thing I got thinking about is that he really didn't achieve their forgiveness at that point. He said, "Father, forgive them," right? They know not what they do. Now, were they forgiven on the spot? No. This prayer had more to it than just this moment. And I know they weren't forgiven on the spot because on the day of Pentecost, for example, in Acts 2, the next time we go through the cycle of the Jews and their sins and all, they come to a place where they've heard a bunch of wind coming in and people fire on their head and they wonder what's going on. And Peter eventually begins to speak and he says, essentially, "You have killed the Christ." Oh, well, I thought he said, "We're forgiven." No, he meant eventually. He meant, "As far as I'm concerned, Lord, we're going to forgive them instead of do what? Condemn them." I don't know what God's wrath would have done had he not said that. I know there was a master plan. But when the Bible talks about a man whose son was killed over a vineyard payment, and the man said, "I'm getting an army and I'm killing every one of them," they realized what God could do and might do. He had done a lot of things to people for less crimes than this. Oh, what shall we do? They were pierced in their heart, it says, and they cried out, "What are we going to do?" Well, I thought he said, "Forgive." Yeah, he's going to forgive you, but there's something he's talking to you, saying, "Father, we're going to forgive them rather than condemn them, and there's going to be a way to do this." And so Peter said, "Yes, there's a way. Repent. Be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ, for remission of your sins. You receive the gift of the Holy Spirit." Now that is one reason why I think Jesus prayed this prayer, to make them realize that there's going to be a process, all right, but he is for their forgiveness, not their condemnation. A lot of people have said, yeah, send down the fire, condemn them, burn them in hell, Lord, because of what they did. And Jesus said, my spirit is for you. I think the second reason Jesus did that is because he practiced what he preached. What does he tell you to do to your enemies? Get even. Do one better. Hurt them really bad. Crush them. Oh. He said, you have an enemy? Forgive me. You have an enemy? Love him. You have an enemy? Do something good for him. You have an enemy? Pray for him. All in Matthew 5. Well, what's the great example of all that? Well, the Father, who loves his enemies so much he sends the rain and the sun on the just and the unjust. This is quite a moment here, though. I mean, it's not just some kind of crime. It's the ultra crime of murder of God's own son. And Jesus said, Father, my spirit, your spirit is what? A very forgiving spirit. I want the world to hear this. So when I died on the cross, I died with an attitude of forgiveness for the whole world, not vengeance. Didn't I tell you something about you've got to come to Christ pretty safely? And he said something like this, he that comes to me, I will in no wise cast out. Well, how do I know that? Well, because of his birth at the cross. The worst thing that happened, he's just saying, Father, forgive them. I forgive them just like I told my disciples to. Then he's trying to tell us now, you Christians, that's the model for you. You have an enemy this bad? You have a person who hurt you this bad as was at the cross? I don't think so. Well, then you can forgive, right? You can show mercy. You can pray. You can do that because he did that as well. But maybe the biggest reason of all of that was because it says in the 53rd chapter of Isaiah, that when Jesus died, he would make intercession for sinners. That's the passage you remember, that he's led like a lamb to the slaughter. He'd open up his mouth, he'd be killed, and he'd be buried with a rich man. That was the chapter that we're talking about. And the very last thing says that he will make intercession for the wicked. What do you mean? Well, he's the go-between. Here's somebody really in bad shape. Here's somebody that can help him. Need somebody to convince this person to give this kind of help. Who can do that? Well, Jesus did. On what conditions? On my death. Father, I want you to be merciful to these people who have killed me. Now that is astounding. Making intercession for the transgressors is what the last verse of 53rd chapter of Isaiah tells us. That's why he said it. Quite a prayer. He was really meaning it. He just a few words. But Father, I'm really begging you, have mercy. Forgive these people. And the forgiveness, of course, again, 50 days later, was finally explained to them on the day of Pentecost, and from then on to the whole world. For the whole world was basically guilty of ignoring God and rejecting his son. He meant what he said. He wants to be your intercessor and mine. He wants to take who we are so sinful before the throne of God and say, God, because of the blood that was shed at the cross, I want you to forgive these folks. They've obeyed what I asked them to do, and because of my blood, they're not going to be forgiven. And the Father says, Son, you're the intercessor. You're the one that did it. And I accept the forgiveness of these people on the basis of who you are and what you did. Talk about a prayer that's hard to pray. My Father, forgive them. They don't understand me. And because of what he said, thousands and thousands and thousands of these people are lining the streets of Jerusalem. Because pretty soon, 5,000 men from this city alone that were following Jesus, plus wives and children. That's quite a group. Because he made intercession rather than condemnation. See, we live in a wonderful age because we live until Jesus comes in the age of reconciliation, in the age of opportunity. Right now, he's wanting to save us. Right now, he's wanting to forgive us of our sins and take all that away and make us new people. That's what he wants to do now. But when he comes, it's altogether different. Hebrews says, he will not come with salvation the second time. He will come in justice and judgment. We have an opportunity today to do the right thing. That's the good news. But we can't put it off. Someday that opportunity will come. Our song, 4:17, nobody understands like Jesus. He went through what we do. He understands problems and difficulties and enemies and all those kind of things and disappointments. He understands you. Better than I, or he else understands you. He understands you. That's why I want you to come to him. So he can make of you what you need to be. He understands that. And he asks you to come to him. Appreciate the first stanza. As we stand, 417.